Yeah! Every musician dreams of one day performing on stage with their favorite band. And for over 20 years, the Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp has been making that dream a reality. One of this year's legendary rock counselors included Motley Crue frontman Vince Neil. Vince and his campers took over Alexis Park for a day of rock.
Wow! Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp.
Yeah.
You're an official camp counselor?
I'm a camp mentor.
Camp mentor.
Whatever you want to call me, I don't care.
And so you have aspiring guitarists coming here to learn from a rock god.
But it's really cool, you know. They get these guys together and some famous rock and rollers come and help them out, and then they learn a bunch of songs and they do them together for the first time. So it's a neat concept.
What's the one piece of advice you would give to them when it comes to being a rock star?
Well, really, it's not really being a rock star, but just a musician. Just if you're in a band and you really believe in it, don't let anybody tell you otherwise.
Let's talk about The Dirt.
Okay.
What a great movie. Netflix, amazing. The guy that played you.
Yeah.
Were you satisfied with the character that played you in the movie?
I think he was great. You know, I talked to him a lot during the filming of the movie, and he really did his homework.
Is there anything in the movie that you watched that the movie got wrong?
No, I mean, actually, everything was really right. Except for sometimes the things that happened were maybe at a different place.
I had managed the Scorpions, Bon Jovi, Skid Row, Kiss, but I had never been through what Motley Crue put me through.
Is it true that Kiss kicked Motley Crue off of the tour because you guys were too rowdy for Kiss?
That's what I heard.
We have some classic records right here, okay? Always want to know, this iconic record of yours, is that you?
That's me.
That's you, right there?
Yeah, because right here,
I never noticed that, right there.
Yep, right there. Frank
Sinatra.
Love him.
Icon, right?
Yeah, I was a buddy of his.
Really?
Yeah, I've been to his house, had drinks with him, drank a lot of Jack Daniels with him. Oh, well, the king.
Yeah.
You know, who can say anything about the king? Nothing bad about him. Girls, girls, girls. Where do you think that came from?
Yeah, that's where you got it from, right? This one right here?
Yeah, that was a very glam, Shout the Devil look.
Beautiful looking man right there.
We were beauty men.
That's beautiful.
Look at Tommy. He looks like a Victoria's Secret model.
Later on in the weekend, Aerosmith guitarist Joe Perry spent time with the campers at Vinyl inside the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino. The afternoon included a Q&A with the man himself. Then it was time for our campers to shred some metal with the Hall of Famer.
We've been watching over the weekend and see your fans that get to play with you. They walk off stage with such joy in their eyes. Some of these people are crying. What's the experience like for you?
Well, it's great to rub elbows with some of the people that I see out in the audience, you know. People come from all walks of life that like to pick up an instrument or sing or whatever, and it's just great to, I always learn something from everybody that plays.
Since we're on stage, dude, can you play something, anything?
At the park for the next 2 weeks, you can hear that all the
way
through.
Pay to go see the residency, I love it.
All right, well, it's that time. You know what we're about to do. You know who's about to come up on the stage. Let's give a big, warm welcome to Vince Neil of Motley Crue. Yeah.
Thank
so much. Vince, it's awesome of you to be back here. How many Rock and Roll Fantasy Camps have you done nowadays?
I think this is my third. I did the very first one. I don't even know how long ago it was. It was a long time ago.
So what keeps, clearly you like it.
You keep coming back.
What is it about it?
Well, it's really the fans and the people learning the music and appreciating music that is not even, of a different time and age, really. We did music, 30 years ago. And for people that are young and still learning it, and like wanting to learn the songs, and so it's really cool.
I always hear headliners say that they wish there was something like this when they were a kid. Who would have been your dream headliner at a Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp?
Oh, jeez. Probably, I don't know, there's so many of them. It was like, back then, it could probably be Robert Plant,
Led Zeppelin. I assume just about everyone here has seen The Dirt, the new Motley Crue movie, yes? Vince, what I found interesting about it is you come in as a kind of already developed character. We don't really get a lot of insight into your childhood and teen years and stuff. So I'm curious, what were you like in high school? Were you the kid that everyone thought was going to be a rock star, or was it a different story?
I was the guy that hung out at the park all the time. When I was 16 is when I was asked to play in a band.
Right.
And I asked why, and they said because they have the longest hair in high school. So they said, well, let's learn some songs. And I said, well, what do you want to play? And so I learned Cheap Trick and some Aerosmith and some AC/DC and Led Zeppelin. And that was it. And then we started playing backyard parties and stuff like that.
So I imagine it was always music for you, but if music hadn't worked out, did you have a backup plan?
No, not really. believe it or not, though, I was actually a good baseball player back when in high school, and I'd actually made the varsity baseball team. But this is one of those moments in time where you the one choice that said you could be on the team and play ball, or but you'd have to cut your hair. And I chose not to cut my hair, so I got into rock and roll. And those life-changing moments.
So once Motley Crue did work out, and you find success in music, I imagine you got to go back to your hometown at some point, and people probably act a little different towards you, right? Now that you're a star.
Well, no, because we started in LA,
right?
And even the beginning of Motley Crue, I was still living at Tommy's house,
right?
At the time, and living in his van and things like that. I was an electrician back then, so I still had a day job. And Tommy, I think he used to paint houses, so we still didn't really have any money until later on. But we still until we signed with a manager who gave us $20 a week, and we thought that was a lot of money. Yeah, we also signed a 20-year contract with the manager because he gave us a $100 bill each.
Sure.
But each, a $100 bill.
That's a lot even to me.
For 20 years, that was a great deal.
But I imagine, once you guys find the super fame, kind of what I meant by that is people got to treat you different once you go back and see people you grew up with, right?
No, it was funny because when me and Tommy and Mickey got that apartment, the infamous apartment by the Whiskey Go-Go, I really didn't see any of my old friends anymore. It was mainly just the four of us all the time.
Sure. Yeah. Now, once in the 80s, I would argue, and The Dirt, the movie, would argue too, that you guys kind of epitomized what everyone's idea of the rock star is. But obviously, touring isn't necessarily what it used to be like. What does being the rock star in 2019 look like, the being out on the road? Are we past the three girls a day?
Back then, really when we first started out, it was the four of us in a station wagon hauling a U-Haul trailer.
Right.
That was us on the road. Then of course it progressed to tour buses and airplanes and on like that. But, you know, you, I think it's funny. I think every band did what Motley Crue did, but they just talked about us more. Mm-hmm. You know, because when you're young, you know, you're in your early 20s, late teens, and you get a lot of money, and there's always girls, and it's rock and roll, and it's having fun, and you know, it can take a toll on you.
Sure.
And you either stop it, well, you know, and continue on with your career, or that it can eat you alive, and you end up, you know, destitute.
I think everyone here will always agree that Motley Crue is the four of you guys, no matter what lineup changes occurred. But I'm curious, did you ever sit down and really listen to the music that they made with Karabi without you?
Tell you the truth, I never heard the record.
Really?
No.
Never heard it. Never been curious.
I wasn't even curious because, you know, what they didn't tell you in the movie was that within a month, you know, I had the song You're Invited But Your Friend Can't Come, you know, with the guys from Night Ranger.
Right.
And then a couple months later, I put out the Exposed album, and then I was on tour opening for Van Halen. So
right.
I had really no interest in listening to the other guys. You know, I was actually too busy.
Right.
And you know, they fired me because they said I was a race car driver. I loved racing, but that wasn't my job.
Right. Right. I mean, the dirt. Was it really difficult to watch? I mean, I heard Tommy say that he was just bawling by the end of it. I mean, you must have had a similar experience too. It must have been.
Well, you know what that movie did was it. You know, it opens up a lot of old wounds.
Right.
You know, and there's things that in the movie that I hadn't thought about in a long time. You know, you get emotional.
Are you happy with the way it turned out overall, though?
I thought it turned out pretty good. I mean,
yeah.
I was really happy. Those guys, I mean, they had us down. You know, I mean, Machine Gun Kelly had Tommy down.
Yeah, I mean, the guy that played you, I mean, it
was amazing. Yeah, we had every single move down back in the early days.
Right, right.
I mean, they really watched like every video, every interview, and they prepared for months.
Sure.
for that movie. I thought they did a great job.
Now, I heard an interview with Mickey not too long ago where he said sometimes he worries the band might have called it a day too early. Do you ever feel that way?
What?
That, you know, the band might have stopped touring too early. Do you ever feel that way, Motley Crue?
Well, I mean, as of like recently, like in 2015?
Right, right. Yeah.
I mean, we could be touring right now.
Right, you know? Absolutely.
There was no reason to stop except for certain people in the band wanted to stop.
Sure.
It's really kind of good.
Right. Now, I just got one last question, then I'm going to open it up for everybody. I believe June 22nd marked 9 years since your last solo album. Are we ever going to see another one out of you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no. I've got a lot of songs in place, and it's just funny. Just because a lot of people didn't know or don't know that for the last 15 or so on years, when Motley didn't play, I was always on tour with my band.
Right.
And so I've constantly been on tour.
Mm-hmm.
And so I finally put some time together and got together with some of the guys, and we wrote a bunch of songs, and hopefully the next year, you know, maybe we'll have it out, but I'm still on tour right now.
Right, right.
So what's up?
We'd all love to see it, right? Awesome, so let's go ahead and open it up to the audience. If anyone has a question, just go ahead and raise your hand and go ahead and ask it. I'm sure someone, yes, over here.
You've not had anonymity for like so many years now. So, would you love that moment where someone doesn't come up to you, you just want to eat dinner and not get a photo op or an autograph? Did you miss that?
You mean, you guys got to speak up because I am still deaf because of rock and roll?
Do you miss anonymity? Do you miss not being, you know, come up to on the streets?
Oh no, people always come up on the streets. You know, there's sometimes I'll be somewhere by, you know, my, you know, bathing suit hat, bathing suit on, and hair in a ponytail, and a hat on, and hey, you're Vince Neil. Yeah. Sometimes I don't know how they recognize me, but I think it's great. Except for when you're in the bathroom, that's not a good spot to say, hey, buddy.
How's it going? Have more people started coming up to you since the dirt came out? Biopics tend to do that.
No, it's always been about the same.
About the same. Yeah. More questions over here.
Hey, Vince, you used to have the Scholar Foundation program for the golf outings and the poker tournament stuff. You still actively promote the Scholar Foundation?
It was a great time to do that stuff, but when the recession hit, a lot of people just couldn't afford to fly out and play golf anymore. Thanks for coming out. But yeah, I miss those days. We raised a lot of money for charity, but it's just a little more difficult in today's climate. Thank you.
Yep, behind it.
I'm curious, you look back on all the single thing from a lot of things, or just one thing that you realize is all
the I got it. I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Not a single favorite moment in your career.
Oh,
single.
Single.
Is there one moment, one memory that just eclipses it all, like you were doing this kind of time?
I think for me, it still is. It's when we were in our early 20s, we have Shout the Devil haven't been out yet, and then we went out and it was the US Festival, and I looked out and there was 350,000 people.
Wow.
And just the awesomeness of that moment of looking out into a sea of people that you couldn't see it in, and with doing music that no one's ever heard before, was a pretty cool moment.
Yeah, if someone has a question, come up to the mic so Vince can hear it better.
Sorry about that.
Hey Vince, love the movie. I'm a psychiatrist by trade. So that movie, I have a lot of my patients watching that before. if you want to see resilience, this is resilient. But you're touring now, your drummer now, with your... That guy,
Zoltan.
He is amazing. Yeah, I've never seen anybody. Where did you find him?
Well, it was funny because I had a drummer for a long time, and he went over to play with Evanescence. So I was looking for a drummer, and my guitar player, Jeff Blando, knew this guy from Florida. He's from Florida. And I had him come out to audition, and he was doing all that stuff. And I was like, you know, tell this guy to knock it off and just play the songs, you know? And he played great, he still does his stuff. You know, now it's just, he has his own show, so it's pretty cool.
Zoltan puts his feet on the drums.
I mean, Zoltan?
He's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Zoltan.
Yeah. Thanks, man.
When you're doing world tour stuff, is there one country that you just really look forward to going to when you see it on the schedule, meaning either the fans are the best or just the other country?
Me and my favorite country? Jeez, I don't know. I mean, of course, playing the U.S. is the best, but I mean, the German crowds during the big festivals, I mean, they're pretty crazy. But that's South America, same thing. We play concerts where there have been, I don't know, 60,000, 70,000 people in torrential rain where you can't see 5 feet in front of you and not one person left. You know, and you're standing out there in the rain singing with them, you know. But it's those a lot of crowds are just very passionate, you know. I just played down in Mexico City, and I mean, everybody's singing every word. And
the opposite of Japan. I saw you guys 3 years ago in Japan, and Japanese don't like to offend the artists by screaming and yelling. They just like to sit there. They're like, what are you doing? Get up.
Yeah,
actually, that crowd is actually pretty good.
But Japan is a whole different thing, too. Yeah. Back in the old days, I remember playing at the Budokan, and there's a guy sitting there with a helmet on and a safety jacket, and his job was, if you sat up, he had a light switch, and it was green. If it went to yellow, that means sit back down, and if you turn the red button on, that means show's over. So it was... a little crazy back then.
Wow.
Actually, not crazy. That was a problem.
Hi, Vince. How you doing?
All right.
All right. Just got curious how you guys came up with your look, the makeup, the clothes. Like, what image came to you to promote the band? You know, like, what's that era you should make it?
How do we come up with the ideas?
Yeah, the ideas, the image, the clothes, whose idea is it? You know.
I mean, every tour is different. You know, I mean, if you know, every tour we had a different look. You know, we went, you know, like I say, from Shout the Devil to Theater of Pain. You know, it was Shout the Devil with leather, you know, heathens, and then all of a sudden we're these glam guys, and then the next record we're bikers, Girls, Girls, Girls. you know, we just wanted to, we never stuck to a formula, really. You know, it was more like, kind of like, which Beatles did you like? Did you like the 60s, the 70s, you know, the 50s, which, it's kind of that.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Obviously, we've seen everything that's come before this moment where we're sitting here watching on stage. So I guess what I was wondering is, for the rest of the time that you have on this planet, what is a dream you have? What is something you have a goal to achieve in the rest of your time here?
The goal for now, for here?
No, for your life. What's a dream that you still have in your heart after all of this time?
I mean, if you're talking about me, like, for the rest of my life, what I want to do, this is it, you know? I mean,
yeah.
I'm a rock and roller. I'm living it. You know?
You got more questions for Vince? There's got to be more questions for Vince. Just come on and line up. But, you know, I've always got a million questions for you. You know, just going off of when we were talking about when you were out of the band and doing your solo stuff, did you think that you were going to be out of the band forever? Did you, you know, were you kind of accepting, I'm going to be a solo artist from now on?
Yeah. I mean, it was, I had a great time being a solo artist, you know, that brief time with Motley Crue would split up.
Right.
I had a great time, and I'm still having a great time.
Sure.
You know, and we would play everything from, you know, smaller, like, you know, 1,500, 2,000 seaters to, you know, 80,000, 90,000 festivals.
Right.
So still doing the same thing, just different guys, and just kind of, let the music do the talking on this stuff.
Sure.
So that was old Tim. That was mine.
What's your relationship with the other guys now, post Motley Crue? Do you still talk to them often or no?
We don't really talk. We text a lot. You know, me and Mickey go back and forth, you know, and Tommy's.
What do members of Motley Crue text about?
not much. I mean, just like, hey, bud, what's happening?
You know, right.
Okay. That's kind of it. Don't really talk with Mick much. But the other guys, yeah, we're still keep in touch.
From what you do know about Mick, is he doing okay right now?
Yeah, it's funny though, because I have a home not too far from him, in the outside of Nashville, and never seen him. He's just Mick is Mick, like in the movie. He just keeps to himself, puts himself in his basement, plays guitar.
That's Mick.
That's what he does.
All right, we got more questions here.
Is racing still a passion, and what's your outlook for that these days?
But racing? I'm still a big racing fan. I have a lot of friends in racing. I go to a lot of the races, and that's about where it is. That's as far as it's going to go. I'm a little too old to get behind the wheel now.
Make go-karts.
Yeah. Anybody who's been on tour knows that there's one song that they go, oh, God, I hate this song. Which one is that for you?
They hate that song?
They hate singing It's Like Not This Song Again.
Could be any of them.
I mean, now that we've learned some of your songs, we want to know which one it is.
Oh, you mean when somebody else plays the song?
No, when you have to sing it.
No, when, you know, look, how many times can you sing Home Sweet Home?
Thank you! There you go.
But you got a really good oh shit moment of being on tour.
Oh shit.
Like an oh shit moment.
There's always those oh shit moments. There's somebody tells you there isn't, they're lying to you. I mean, we've been on stage and everybody makes mistakes. You know, I've been on stage where Mick's playing the wrong song and I'm wondering why it isn't, you know, my voice isn't working. There's been times I forgot. I've done this song a million times, and all of a sudden you get a brain fart and you forget the words, and you're like, "Holy shit!"
Everyone, just feel free to line up when you have a question. I'm curious about you know, the Dirt soundtrack. Obviously, the title track, The Dirt, features Machine Gun Kelly.
How did that come to happen, getting a rapper on a Motley Crue song?
I don't know, because I had nothing to do with the writing of that song.
Okay.
I know that Tom and him were friends.
Right, yeah.
And so I think that's probably where it kind of came from. I think because the movie was first before the soundtrack, obviously. So with him being who he is, I think Tommy probably said, "Hey man, just put on the record." You know?
Right, right.
Now, do you ever get, you know, do you think you'll call it quits at all in the next couple of years, or do you think you're going to be doing this for life, touring?
Well, I mean, I love being on tour. You know, until people stop asking me to complain, I'll still be out there.
Sure.
You know, it's like this year, we're doing 120-something shows, you know, which is a lot of shows. And I imagine next year will probably be the same.
Sure. You got more questions here?
I'm just wondering about the Fort Cameron movie. How did you end up in that movie? And did you ever have the aspiration beyond music to be in film that movie was from?
I mean, I think we all, like back in the early days of Motley, you know, remember the movie The Lost Boys? They were going to put Motley Crue as those guys, the vampire guys. And thank God they didn't do it. I've done a couple, like a little bit, a tiny bit of film work, and those guys work too hard. Yeah. You know, I'd rather just be on stage and sing than what those guys go through.
Kiss
has been around, you know, since the early 70s. I mean, I was in high school cranking Kiss, you know. But with Motley, we had a lot of influences. You know, one was, of course, Kiss with the theatrics. One was also the New York Dolls. It was also the Sex Pistols. And it kind of goes on from there. But, well, yeah,
I think it was
but Kiss is, you know, Kiss is stage theatrics. Absolutely, you know. But and when we played with them,
that
even had to up the game.
That's how I should phrase it.
Yeah.
It's just wanting to stay.
Yeah.
All right, well, I think that I just got the cue that we are good to go. We got to get everybody jamming with Vince soon. So let's give another round of applause for Vince.